After graduating from her undergraduate at the University of Glasgow, she started her PhD at the University of Cambridge. While doing her PhD, she observed a series of periodic signals from the sky, later found to be rotating neutron stars or pulsars. Throughout her research career, she has worked for many distinguished institutions around the world. She was also the president of the Royal Astronomical Society and is currently a visiting professor at the University of Oxford. Alongside her scientific career, she has become a role model for women in science and has been actively working to make the physics community more inclusive and diverse.
Yes, thank you, Claire. Yeah, today she'll be sharing a bit more in detail about all the challenges and sort of the path she has had in astrophysics as a woman, and also all the efforts being made and needed to make this field of research more inclusive for everyone. Yes, thank you.
So is my screen seen okay? Great, thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation to be with you. I hope I'm going to cover stuff that you will find of interest. What I was going to do was to say a bit about being in Cambridge as a graduate student, about imposter syndrome and the discovery of pulsars, about what happened next, about gendering, and about the road to equality in UK universities. I'm going to have to keep moving as that's quite a large agenda, but if I skip things you're interested in, perhaps you can ask questions about that of me at the end. So this is a photograph of the famous radio telescope at Jodrell Bank, which is part of the University of Manchester. It was one of the early radio astronomy telescopes, and it has now become a World Heritage Site, which means the university has to keep it standing, which will probably be quite expensive. But wonderful to think that a piece of scientific equipment can be a World Heritage Site. Radio astronomy developed at the end of the Second World War, when people who had been working in radar took some of the radar receiving equipment, they weren't interested in the transmitters, just the radar receiving equipment, took them back to their universities and started using that equipment to see if they could pick up radio signals from things in the sky, things in space. And they found they could. They found a lot of quite strong radio emitting objects. And they would say to their colleagues, the optical astronomers, what is there at such and such a position in the sky? Because we're getting a strong radio signal from it, whatever it is. And the optical astronomers would say, well, there's something that looks a bit like a star, although I can't recognize its spectrum. I don't know what kind of star it is. So these things became known as quasi-stellar radio sources, or quasars for short. The question about what kind of object they were and their spectrum was cracked a few years later by Martin Schmidt, in particular, in Caltech. Martin was an optical astronomer of Dutch extraction, and he had got a spectrum of one of the brightest quasars, and he could not understand the spectrum. There were lines in it, but he didn't know what element it was. His colleague along the corridor, Jesse Greenstein, had the spectrum of another quasar and was equally rather puzzled and was in the process of writing a paper explaining why this object, whatever it was full of tellurium, because tellurium was the only thing he could get to even approximately fit the spectrum. Martin Schmidt continued to puzzle, and he said to himself, it's awfully like a hydrogen spectrum, but it's in the wrong part of the spectrum. It's too red. And then he wondered if it could actually be a hydrogen line spectrum with a large redshift. And he found it fitted with a very large redshift. So he went along the corridor to his colleague, Jesse, and his tellurium paper and said, Jesse, do you think your quasar spectrum could be hydrogen with a large redshift? And Jesse tried that idea and found, yes, it would. It was a slightly different redshift from Martin's one, but it was broadly in the same ballpark. So it looked as if these things were very distant because they knew the universe was expanding, and the further away you went, the faster it was expanding and the larger the redshift. The snag about these things being very distant objects was they were incredibly bright, and normally distant objects are fainter than the nearby ones. But both statements were correct. These things are bright and they are very distant. Okay, so pause the science there. I started life at number one on this map in Northern Ireland. I had some of my schooling in the north of England, and then I went to university in Glasgow. I had decided before I left school that I would really like to be a radio astronomer. And Jodrell Bank was an obvious place to do it. While I was an undergraduate in Glasgow, I applied to Jodrell Bank to do a PhD and heard nothing. I had worked there the previous summer, and the graduate students there told me that they wouldn't take a woman. So when Jodrell didn't reply, I thought this is their way of not taking a woman. I'm going to go to Australia to do my PhD, probably Sydney, but the academic year there does not begin till January or February. I have quite a few months in hand. I put an application into Cambridge just in case, not really believing I'd get in there. And very much to my surprise, got a place. So Cambridge is at point four on this map. And you can see it's a lot further south than I have ever been, ever lived. It's foreign territory. When I got to Cambridge, I felt very much like a fish out of water. Everybody was extremely brilliant, quite keen to let you know it, very suave, very confident, and I felt like some kind of country bumpkin come to town. I don't know if you'd agree with this rather cheeky map and the gradient, but I felt when I was in the south of England, as I am now, is that folk up north are considered to be slightly uncouth and somewhat like savages, whereas down south is ultimate civilization. You can see I still have a northern accent, so I don't totally buy into this, folks. I realize now when I got to Cambridge, I suffered from imposter syndrome. But back then we didn't identify or name imposter syndrome. That's been a much more recent recognition. I thought everyone in Cambridge was terribly clever, and I wasn't, that they'd made a mistake admitting me, they were going to discover their mistake and they'd throw me out. I now work in Oxford and Cambridge and possibly even Manchester have to look out for new students suffering imposter syndrome, because that's what this is. There is a risk that the student will run away within the first week of the first term and never be seen again because they're quite convinced they're not clever enough. We're getting better at looking out for it and spotting it, I must say. Well, my discomfort was not helped when in the first week, I and the other three or four new radio astronomy graduate students were each given a set of tools. And this is my set of tools. They are not microelectronics tools, they're full-size wire working tools, heavy duty stuff, because that's what I was going to be doing. I spent the first 2 years of my PhD building a radio telescope. Quite a lot of outdoor work. This particular slide shows a little bit of work in the field, so to speak, literally. I'm the person on the bottom right corner, huddled up. And my technician, Don, is working with me at this point. My particular job was all the plugs and connectors on cables. And we're checking the connectors on this set of cables to make sure that the connections are good. I've got a slotted waveguide in front of me, and we're using that to check the impedance. There were six of us building a huge radio telescope. It covered an area of about 57 tennis courts, several football pitches. My responsibility was all the cables, connectors, transformers. There was a lot of sledgehammering involved, is it? You see lots and lots and lots of posts. I was spared most of the sledgehammering, but by the end of my PhD, I could swing a sledgehammer. Or put more usefully, I could hit a hockey ball from one corner of the field to the diagonally opposite corner. This radio telescope was working at quite a low frequency, 81.5 megahertz. There are over 2,000 antennae there. And lots of cables to connect them up. The wooden posts are to keep everything out of the wet grass, because wet grass is a perfect short. It's almost 200 kilometers of wire and cable. It worked as an interferometer, and the receivers were constructed with valves, vacuum tubes. Transistors had come in. I'd used them in my undergraduate project, but Cambridge University radio astronomy still hadn't converted. They did ultimately change to transistors. Now, the purpose of this project was to find more quasars, and the technique used was a scintillation or twinkling technique. If you don't want to follow the details of the next slide or so, let me remind you that if you look at the night sky, the way you tell the difference between a star and a planet is that stars twinkle and planets don't. Although planets are much smaller than stars, they're much closer and they subtend a larger angle at your eye than do the stars. So the stars are twinkling because they are smaller angular diameter. The planets are not twinkling because they are larger angular diameter. There's something equivalent happens in radio astronomy. And these diagrams, I hope, will help explain it. There's a quasar. It's actually way, way, way off the top because it's very, very far away. There's a radio telescope here on the ground. And between the two is the material coming off the sun, the solar wind. There's plasma blowing off the sun. And the plasma's not perfectly uniform. There are some clouds with higher electron density. And so this wind, this plasma, acts a bit like a diffraction grating, and the wave gets spread out. But the grating is moving past because the solar wind is carrying these electron density irregularities. And the net result is that the radio telescope picks up a rapidly fluctuating signal. This is 1 second, this little bar. Now, that's true for a quasar, but if you have any other kind of radio-emitting object, radio galaxies, they are much broader. You see them through the gaps as well as through the clouds, and the clouds blowing by don't have the same effect, and you get a reasonably steady signal from a radio galaxy or any broader, larger angular diameter object. If you're going to look for this rapid fluctuations to pick out the quasars, you need a short integration time, less than a second. But if you have a short integration time, you make your signal to noise dreadful. So you get around that by building a very large radio telescope to bump up your signal and improve the signal to noise. So it's a very neat technique, but it did need a large radio telescope. At the time I started, there were about 20 quasars known. Project was to find more. We used a time constant, an integration time of a tenth of a second. I used that telescope for about 6 months and found about 180 more quasars. So the number went up from 20 to about 200, and we had a good sample. At that time, this is 1960, second half of the 1960s, University of Cambridge had a computer, a computer, one computer, to serve the whole university. It had memory comparable with the memory of your laptop, and clearly very few people could use it. And my supervisor did not have access to it. So our data came out on rolls of paper chart, and this is a mock-up of me analyzing some of the paper chart. There was 30 meters of this stuff produced every day. I did a complete sky scan every 4 days, so that's 120 meters per sky scan, and I ran it for 6 months. So I had over 5 kilometers of this paper. I very quickly got used to identifying the quasars. They were great. I also, of course, picked up, or it also picked up, a lot of artificial signal interference. In those days, a badly suppressed car would produce radio emission. Anything that sparked, arc welders, for instance, gave radio emission. Some pirate radio stations found that there was this empty radio frequency, kept clear for radio astronomy, and wasn't it a wheeze that they broadcast in that frequency? So for some time we couldn't do anything because we could only pick up Radio Caroline. But I got plenty of data. I got used to identifying the interference. I got used to identifying the twinkling quasars. And just very occasionally, there was something else that I couldn't make sense of. On this little bit of the chart paper, there is some low-level interference, and there's a sample of this other signal. And they look different. And if you'll excuse me teaching you a little bit of physics as we go along, why do they look different? Well, here, the spikes go up and down. Here, the spikes go largely up. Here, you can see space between the spikes. Here, at least at the left-hand end, the spikes are so closely packed, you can't see space between them. When you make that kind of comparison, you are doing a Fourier analysis. Fourier analysis asks about the amplitudes of the different frequencies, so positive and negative, positive only, and it asks about what frequencies are present. Lower frequencies, you can see space between the spikes, higher frequencies. So you actually do Fourier analysis almost unconsciously. And I hope you find that reassuring, because I was very puzzled by Fourier analysis as a student. So there's a signal that looks different. It doesn't look like a twinkling quasar. It doesn't look like man-made interference. It was very intermittent. And it was only perhaps after I'd seen it about 10 times that my brain said, "You've seen something like this before, haven't you? You've seen something like this before from this bit of sky, haven't you?" And then it's easy, because I can get out all the other rolls of chart paper that cover this bit of sky, lay them out on the floor. The grad students all worked in an attic and there was a lot of floor, and line it up so that the same bits of sky were lined up. And I could see that, yeah, it wasn't often present, but when it was present at the same right ascension, as we call it, from the same part of sky. But it was very tiny. It occupied about 10 parts in a million of the chart paper. But the human brain, I think, logs things it doesn't understand. Maybe you have experienced that the bits of physics you don't understand really bug you. This signal was like a bit of physics that I didn't understand. It bugged me. My supervisor pointed out that this occupied about a quarter of an inch. We couldn't really see what was going on. We needed an enlargement. And with this technology, there is one advantage. To get an enlargement, you run the paper faster under the pen and it all gets spread out, enlarged. The snag is, if I left the paper running at that speed always, it would run out of paper every 20 minutes. And that wasn't good news. So it was the grad student's job to go out to the observatory at about this time, switch to high speed, let it run at high speed to about this time, and then switch back to normal. And I did that for a month, and I made recordings of receiver noise. The thing had disappeared. And then one day I got it. Along the bottom are 1 second time pips. This is the signal that came in. That labeling is from later. You can see clear pulses here, equally spaced. There's one missing, but those are back on cue. Maybe, maybe, and two little ones on cue. And similarly along here, three more on cue. Even when the strength of the signal disappears, it keeps the beat. And the separation of the pulses is about 1 1/3 seconds. I'd seen nothing like this before. I phoned my supervisor, who was in the middle of Cambridge. Don't think he believed me. He came out to the observatory the next day at the appropriate time and stood looking over my shoulder and saw it for himself, and also saw that the period hadn't changed since the previous day. It looked awfully like radio interference. The snag was it kept sidereal time. You know that there are different constellations in the night sky in summer and winter. That's because the stars go round in 23 hours, 56 minutes, not 24 hours. That 23 hours, 56 minutes is called the sidereal day. And this thing was keeping to the sidereal day. Was there some fault with the equipment? Had Jocelyn wired it up wrong? It's always the graduate student's fault. Just be warned if any of you are thinking of doing a PhD. So we asked a colleague who had another radio telescope and their own receiver, also working in the same band, and they managed to see it. So it wasn't a fault with our equipment. But it was a real puzzle. It has very short pulses with very steep sides, so that meant it has to be small. And yet it kept pulsing very, very accurately. It didn't get tired, which meant it had big energy reserves, which meant it was big. And it wasn't clear how to resolve that. Then a colleague managed, using two of my receivers, one tuned up a bit in frequency and one tuned down a bit in frequency, to get both of them working at the same time and when the source was obliging. And he found that the pulse came in the higher frequency receiver slightly before the lower frequency receiver. That means the signal is dispersed, a bit the way a light ray is dispersed by a raindrop or a prism into its colors, its constituent frequencies. And going by the amount of separation between the signal and the two receivers, he managed to estimate that the thing was about 200 light years away, which put it well beyond the solar system, but well within the Milky Way. My supervisor was still hung up on the idea that it might be something artificial. And I nicknamed these things LGM for little green men. My supervisor knew that if they were little green men, if it was little green men, they'd probably live on a planet that went round their sun. And as their planet went round their sun, we should see a Doppler shift in the frequency, the spacing of the pulses. So I kept making observations of these pulses, and we did find a Doppler shift, but it was due to the motion of the Earth round the sun. So we'd proved the Earth went round the sun, yippee, but otherwise weren't making much progress. And then I found a second one, and a few weeks after that, a third and a fourth. And suddenly it began to feel like a new kind of something with lots of them. And I'd found the first four. And I have to say, life got a lot better then. It's very unlikely to be little green then. It's something natural, though at that stage, we hadn't a clue what. It turned out that these things were neutron stars, now called pulsars. And I found the first four. Because the title of my thesis had already been set long ago and supervisor said it couldn't be changed, the pulsars went in an appendix to the thesis. Probably read much more than the main thesis, but never mind. I got engaged to be married between discovering pulsars 2 and 3. My husband worked in local government. And to get promotion in local government, you have to move to another locality. And so every 5 or 10 years, we'd move. And I had to up sticks and leave whatever job I had and go find another. In addition, we had a child born 4 or 5 years later. And at that stage, it was proven, note the inverted commas, proven that if a mother'd worked, the children would be delinquent. And so there were very, very few childminding facilities because they didn't want to encourage mothers to work. If this were a live lecture, I would be asking you at this point, how many of your mothers worked? And I think quite a lot of hands might go up. I'd then ask how many of you are delinquent? And there'd probably be one or two on the back row who put their hand up at that point. Yep, thank you, excellent. So it was proven that people would be delinquent if their mothers worked. So they didn't want mothers to work. So a lot of my career after my PhD was really a succession of jobs, which you can dress up as a portfolio career. But it felt a bit like a game of snakes and ladders. We'd land somewhere, I'd get a job, I'd climb up the ranks in that job. Husband would say, it's time I moved to another area. I'd slide down a snake to a new place. I'd have to find a new ladder, climb up that ladder, repeat over and over again. But I've had fun. I started doing my PhD in radio astronomy. I then moved to gamma ray astronomy. We then moved again. I moved to X-ray astronomy. We then moved again. I did infrared and millimeter wave astronomy. And then the marriage broke up and I went and worked for the Open University, and we did astronomy across the whole spectrum, studying binary star systems. So I've been a researcher, a university lecturer, a tutor, a manager, a professor, a head of department, a dean. I've done public relations and outreach. Found that being persistent is a good idea, so I would recommend to you that you be persistent. But be prepared to take risks. I have had to take risks and I've surprised myself several times. Also note that one failure doesn't make a disaster. Einstein had a rather shaky start to his career. Aim as high as you can, but particularly if you're a woman and maybe have your career disturbed a bit by children, try and keep your options open as far as you can. So I've given quite a lot of thought to the role of women in physics. We are still very much in a minority, as I will show you in a little bit. But we still have situations in Britain, not so many girls do A-level physics, for example, although a lot of girls do biology and quite a lot do chemistry. And I have started thinking about how we bring up girls and boys, how differently we bring up girls and boys. And this is some material from an organization called Let Toys Be Toys. The girls part of a toy shop and the boys part of a toy shop. This is a particularly striking example, I must admit. Girls in particular know from very early what it means to be a girl. I think the boys have a slightly broader education. And these are the words used by advertisers to describe girls' and boys' toys. And the girls' ones are very pretty and fairly passive, unadventurous. The boys are much more outgoing, I think rather more exciting as well. But can you see the kind of conditioning that goes on quite early on through toys? And even if parents try and bring up boys and girls similarly, grannies and aunts and uncles may get won over by this form of advertising and give very gender-specific toys. This is the A-level results from 2019. In biology, almost two-thirds of the A-level class is female. In chemistry, interestingly, it's rather similar, but in physics, less than a quarter of the class are girls. Very striking differences. And I'm sorry about this. I think it would be great if more girls would do physics, but clearly it has an image problem, is it? Or just quite why? Why is physics not attractive to girls? Who's telling them it's not for girls? I don't think that they find it more difficult if they do it. But there's definitely a shortage of girls doing physics at A levels. There have also been issues in universities, particularly physics departments. So I'm going to say just a few words about equality of the male and female in UK universities. Science and engineering has been male dominated since it was created. And whilst I don't think the men are deliberately sexist or discriminating, perhaps there is some lack of thoughtfulness about whether there are other ways of doing physics, other ways of running physics departments that might make them more female friendly. Increasingly in universities these days, data are collected. How many women, how many men are there at each level? It showed that women were in a minority. Oh yes, the minority gets smaller the higher the level. It shows that women progress more slowly than men up the ranks. It showed that women put in fewer grant applications for smaller amounts of money, were less willing to apply for jobs. And so suddenly there was a need to fix the women, make the women braver, more willing to put in grant applications, more willing to apply for promotion or apply for jobs. And for a short while, there were special training courses for women to address these deficiencies. Now, the snag about labeling that as deficiencies is it assumes the problem is with the women, and there's absolutely no problem, thank you, with the way science or society is run. The next attempt was returner funding, special funding for women coming back from, say, maternity leave. And initially these were only open to women, but unfortunately there were some absolutely charming gentlemen who would say to those women, you only got that position because you're a woman, you're not up to the standard of the rest of us, you ought to leave. So increasingly these types of funding are open to both men and women. And of course, increasingly, men are also taking paternity leave to look after small children, so they too can have career breaks. But the funding agencies began to realize that giving special funding to individual women was great for those women, but didn't actually change the ambiance in the workplace at all. And they began to look for what they call institutional change. And the Athena Swan program, which some of you may have heard about, was devised. I was one of a small group of women that set that up, asking how woman-friendly is your university or your department? And increasingly the funding bodies required a department or a university to hold one of these awards before they could apply for research funding. And when funders start taking notice, wow, change happens. That's known as the Athena Swan Scheme. It got extended from sciences to arts and humanities, where the question is, where are the men, not where are the women? It got extended to Ireland, to Australia, to Canada, and it's also now coming in the USA, where they've also bound in things like gender identity and race as well. So it's having quite an impact one way and another. Give you some clue about what institutional change might be. I want to stress that you can have individuals who are not sexist, not discriminating, but can be working in an environment that is in a subtle way discriminating or sexist. Its structures are sexist. So, and examples of institutional sexism are possible biases in recruitment or promotion, retention, unawareness of different management styles, unconscious bias. And my favorite example is at the bottom of this slide. You've probably had to fill in a form sooner or later which asked which sex or gender you were, and you were given a couple of boxes. Well, these days you'd be given more, but in the old days you were given a couple of boxes. Tick one. What order do those boxes come in? Usually male, female. Is that alphabetical order? No. That is a prime example of unconscious bias. There is absolutely no reason to put the M before the F, but we often still do. So is the situation in Britain unique or typical of other countries? There's a body called the International Astronomical Union, which is for professional astronomers. So most academic astronomers, astrophysicists will belong, because in addition to having countries as members, individuals can be members. And I've been using this data to see whether our country was exceptionally good or exceptionally bad about women in astronomy. It's been collecting data on membership disaggregated by sex for quite a while. And the first thing to say is there's quite a range around the world of the fraction of astronomers who are female. I've focused on countries with more than 200 members, so as the root N error is not too big. And this is the percentage of astronomers who are female in countries with more than 200 astronomers in membership. And Italy is the best country with 26% of its professional astronomers being female. France, 25%, Brazil, Spain, Russia. The world average is 17%, which is pretty poor, but it's going up slowly. Australia is below the world average, Canada is below the world average, USA is below the world average. UK is the other English-speaking country in that sort of block. We are all below the world average. And since the USA makes up about a quarter of the total membership, it's quite clever of the USA to be below the world average. Northern European countries like Germany and the Netherlands come next, India and Japan. It's perhaps not surprising that Japan has a very low figure. So Southern Europe and also Latin America have high percentage females. Northern Europe and the English speaking countries have low percentage females. And whilst that's, it does at least say to me that the limiting factor is culture, not women's brains. And I'm told that there's similar distributions by country for physics and for maths, but the international bodies there don't collect the data in the same way, so we can't do the same analysis. The membership is for tenured astronomers, so there'll be larger numbers of younger women who are not counted. You have to be nominated by your country's astronomical society. That may be a filter. And if anybody wants to follow up, there's the website for the data. It's very interesting. It's updated every month. And at that point, I will stop and say thank you for your interest. Thank you for your attention. Maybe we've got some time for questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think Tim and Shresht from AstroSoc are going to take over the Q&A, so I'll leave it to them.
So I was just wondering how much time did we have for questions, Dr. Bunnell?
Oh, I'm okay for 15, 20 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So if anyone has any questions, please feel free to put them on the chat or raise your hands. Either way, it's fine. The first question is here from Jitin. He asks, if during your PhD you had felt hindered in your creativity in physics by needing to recheck and confirm your results more often than male peers, and he thanks for the incredible.
There weren't any male peers in exactly the same situation, it so happened. So it wasn't obvious that I was having to check more than my male colleagues.
Thank you. Eric asks, have there been moments in your career/degree that you felt disheartened and like physics wasn't for you, and how did you get past this?
Yeah, quite a lot actually. Several times in my undergraduate degree where I found some of the subjects quite hard, particularly the more theoretical ones. And because I was the only female, I didn't really have any buddies to work with, so I had to sort them out myself, which was probably good training for something, but it was quite hard at the time. During the PhD, all the graduate students were in this attic and we kind of supported each other. Everything that happened there was very public, so if your PhD supervisor came up and booed you, the whole group knew. Equally, if they came and praised you, the whole group knew.
Thank you. Kay asks, do you have any advice for overcoming imposter syndrome?
I think my strategy I would commend to others, work really hard. Hang in there is the first thing. Work really hard. Okay, maybe you be like me, you're telling yourself you will get thrown out, but you're going to do your very best until you get thrown out, so that you won't have a guilty conscience when you do get thrown out. You know you've done your best, and okay, it just wasn't good enough, but you've done your best. So I think trying to do your best is probably the best way of overcoming imposter syndrome. Hang in there. Try your very hardest.
Thank you. We have a raised hand from Emma Hattersley. Can you unmute yourself and ask a question?
You're muted.
Yeah. Sorry, it wouldn't let me unmute my microphone. I've just done it. I want to work in media and science after university. So I was wondering how you think the media can play a larger role in encouraging women into physics?
Yeah, the media are getting a lot better. They used to be very, very bad about what they saw the role of women in life to be, but they've got much, much better. And there are now a lot of women in the media itself. So It is much, much better. Probably women are still in a minority, so you might be prepared for that, but you certainly won't be alone. And if you've got the ability to do something independent, maybe you go talk to some women scientists, you know, do a feature on them or something like that, which would not only help the women scientists, but probably encourage more girls to become scientists.
Thank you. I think Emily asks, why did you want to be a radio astronomer from a really early age?
I discovered astronomy when I was about age 13, 14, maybe even earlier than that. And I thought, right, I'll be an astronomer. And then somebody pointed out to me that astronomers work at night. And I knew I needed my sleep. I still need my sleep. I could not regularly work at night. So I thought, oh, I can't be an astronomer. And then I got to hear about the new astronomies that were starting post-World War II. Radio astronomy arising out of radar, and X-ray astronomy arising from the rockets that we could then launch. And in both these cases, the observations are done day and night, so the astronomers can keep office hours normally, not always, but mostly. So X-ray astronomy sounded really a bit dodgy, you know, rockets could fail and that kind of thing. So I opted for radio astronomy.
Thank you. We have a question from Angelica. Do you have any advice on managing family responsibilities and a career at university?
That is really difficult. And you're going to be very torn between responsibility to children, and responsibility to your degree course as well. And there isn't a simple solution. Obviously, being efficient, make good use of any spare time you have, that kind of thing. But also, I think partners should be encouraged to play their part as well. And I think more and more young men are turning out to be much better husbands than their predecessors, their parents were. So that's helpful and that's encouraging.
Thank you for your answer. There's a question.
Eric asks, what do you believe the most substantial changes a university or organization can make to combat the institutional biases you talked about?
Well, that's a great question. First of all, to be aware that there might be. Secondly, to gather data, you know, how many women, how many men do you have? Are they getting promoted at equal rates? Given coronavirus and the impact it has had on women's careers, that's a very pertinent question at the moment. And I don't quite know how we're going to handle that one. But gathering any data you can gather about how women and men are progressing, how much they're publishing, how their research is going, how their teaching is going, that's probably about the best you can do.
All right, thank you for your answer. The next question is from Emma Alexander. She says, brilliant talk, thank you. My question is, you spoke about how moving around early in your career hindered your progression due to sliding down the snake each time. What are your thoughts on the current academic norm of moving around from place to place until a permanent position, if you're lucky, i.e. the expectation to do postdocs in different locations, etc.? And how they impact researchers for whom it is much harder to move countries every few years.
Yeah. Getting the chance to work in different countries is very, very interesting. And I only had one chance to work overseas, which was in the USA. And I was a very mature person by that stage. It is difficult if you have to keep moving. On the other hand, it is very enriching. The problem is if it's a dual career family, and maybe also you've got to worry about schooling for kids, that it can get quite complicated. But actually, I'm surprised to note that even now in the midst of the virus, we have academics coming and going, moving jobs. So it's still going on. It is rather much part of being a young scientist. And although there obviously are logistical and practical difficulties, seeing how they do things in another country is really very revealing.
Thank you so much. Edmondo asks, as a radio astro graduate who has gone into teaching, I have been battling with the statement physics is a boys thing coming from both students and other teachers. What would be your advice to teachers of physics/radio astro or physics graduates on how to eradicate or at least alleviate this rhetoric?
Yeah, that's a very difficult one because it seems very well entrenched. Check the Institute of Physics website. The Institute of Physics is concerned about the shortage of women in physics, the shortage of girls doing A-level physics, and they have quite a lot of resources. Get hold of posters of women scientists, preferably women physicists, and put them up all around the place to show that there are women, there are successful women, and to give the girls who may be feeling a bit beleaguered some role models. And in things like practical classes in schools, make sure it does not end up with the guys doing the experiment and the girls taking the notes. Typical, you know, gender division. Stop it.
Thank you. The next question is from Labiba Islam. Do you think it is harder for a woman or an ethnic minority to work in a British university compared to one overseas?
I've got very limited knowledge of women working in physics overseas because there were barely any women in the place I worked in the USA in physics. But it is important not only to have gender diversity, but every other kind of diversity you can. It's been shown by some management consultants called McKinsey's in the USA that the most successful workplace has the most diverse workforce. It also has to be well managed, it has to be said. Diversity is a strength, and the most fragile arrangement is a research group that's made of lookalikes who think alike and reinforce each other's ideas, whether they're right or wrong. You desperately need diversity in science. And that's why I gave the breakthrough money, the $3 million to the Institute of Physics to fund graduate studentships, PhD studentships, for students from minority in physics groups to increase the diversity in physics. Diversity is a strength, an important strength.
Thank you so much for your answer. Hannah asks, I've seen widening participation initiatives use language on publicity materials that say things like, we're showing girls that they can do STEM too. Do you think that sort of language works, or does it risk being counterproductive, introducing doubts where previously there were none?
If it does introduce doubt where there was none, then it's clearly doing damage. But actually, I think there is a lot of doubt still. Maybe not so much amongst, no, maybe everywhere. I was going to say maybe more with the parents' generation and the girls, but thinking of it, I'm not sure that's true. I think there still is an image problem for girls, particularly during the physical sciences. Biological sciences, there's a lot of girls, but getting them into physics, engineering, even maths is not easy.
Thank you. Joe Spike asks, what particular things do you believe men can do and consider to reduce their unconscious biases in physics or in society generally?
Thank you. That's a nice question. I think where you notice bias, call it out. Don't make a great fuss about it, but you know, oh, by the way, John, do you realize you're showing unconscious bias kind of thing? Because it is unconscious bias and you don't realize you're doing it. The people listening to you may hear it, but you don't. So I think helping people to see without accusing them of anything, but helping them to see where their language may be biased. And the same thing obviously goes with not just with gender, but with race and, well, to some extent with gender identity as well.
Thank you so much. We have a couple of people who've posted some really good comments, but I will skip that for the question next. Miriam asks, how do you think we can best tackle these issues of diversity? Are there any existing programs or schemes you'd recommend getting involved with? For example, outreach and et cetera.
Yeah, outreach is important because in the last analysis, we've got to convince girls and their mothers and fathers that girls can do science. So anything that converts the public to seeing that women can do science is really important. So even if you convert the girls and their parents, then there's all the cousins and the aunts and the uncles and grannies. And changing the way a culture thinks is quite a big job. So outreach is one very good one. And it's great if women can do some outreach, but beware you don't get lumbered with more than your fair share, because people will say, it's so important we show that there's girls doing physics. You, the girls, must go do outreach. And that's not fair.
Thank you so much. I think that's the last of the questions, but I'll take this opportunity to read a couple of the really nice comments. Simone has said, thank you for a very encouraging talk. I was the only woman on my maths and physics degree in 1984. I've spent 25 years teaching A-level physics and have just returned to work on a PhD in physics. Definitely suffering from imposter syndrome, but sticking with it. Thank you for the confidence boost.
Oh, lovely. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a question from Otto. So in your opinion, does the problem you have talked about exist only in the field of physics? I think it could also appear in the more modern fields of science, computer science, for example.
Yes, it's not just physics. It's there in engineering, it's there in computer science. And to a degree, it's there in the subjects like biology that have a lot of women undergraduates. When you get to faculty level, it can be there as well. So it's quite common, which is why it's really important to have the kind of data we are collecting on how many women faculty you have, how many men, how are they progressing, and so on.
Thank you so much. I think that is there's one last question. Could you share a few encouraging improvements you've seen over the years and in which areas?
I think what I found most encouraging is, although it's a lot of work, when departments are doing their Athena Swan return, they're counting how many women students they have, how many men students, how many women faculty, how many men faculty, and all this kind of thing. And for the first time, they see it in black and white before their eyes. And it's often quite a surprise to people just what their gender balance is. And suddenly, for the first time, they see and they realize they have an issue.
Thank you so much. I think that's all the questions we have. Maybe Claudia or Claire, one of you can just wrap the thing up.
Yes, thank you so much again for coming. Thank you, WISE, also for helping us, and IOP for all the help. It was a very good talk. I think we all really enjoyed it. So,
thank you very much.
And thank you all. Thank you very much. And some excellent questions too. Have a good evening, everybody. Keep safe. Keep going. Don't give up.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.